Hello and welcome to episode 90 of the Rock and Roll Beer Guy podcast. This episode is brought to you by our good friends at Cosmic Eye Beer. Cosmic Eye Brewing is located in Lincoln, Nebraska. My homie Sam Riggins is the owner, creator, founder, CEO, all those awesome titles you want to throw at him. He's the brainchild of Cosmic Eye Beer. He was on episode 4 with Sacha from Intronaut, and you can hear him talking about the idea of opening up this brewery. He already had, you know, plans in the works, but it wasn't official yet, and now their doors are open. You can go visit them now. I've followed their whole journey on Instagram, and you can see pictures of them building out the furniture. It was a labor of love. This isn't some kind of corporate beer company that, you know, just shelling out money from Budweiser or anything like that. This is real craft beer, true metalheads. If you show up on Monday, they have Metal Mondays, where if you show up at the brewery with a metal shirt or anything like that, you'll get $1 off a full pint pour. And you'll get a chance to win some cool stuff. They just recently released their cans. If you're in Nebraska, you can pick up the Unlock the Time Dragon IPA. Everything Has Eyes Post-Hazy IPA. They got their Gaze of the Basilisk Black Lager, Round and Round Mild Ale, and Laser Quest 2.0 Brewed IPA with Hibiscus. If you're not in Nebraska, I highly recommend you find a website that'll ship to you. Or find some friends in Nebraska. It's not hard to find a beer group online. Get there and ask them to send you some. In this episode, I talked to Richard Vreeland, a.k.a. Disasterpeace. Rich invited me to his studio up in L.A., and we got to hang out for a bit. We grabbed a bite to eat, and we sat down and had a few beers, had a great conversation about his career, about music in general. We talked a little bit about video games. If you're not familiar with his work, I highly recommend you check it out. He did the soundtracks for certain video games like Hyper Light Drifter and Fez. And he's also done the soundtrack for several movies like It Follows and Under the Silver Lake. We talk a bit about that and what it's like to work with a full symphony orchestra. I had a great time talking to him, and I hope you guys enjoy. Don't forget to follow him on social media. And don't forget to check out our Patreon page. Go to patreon.com/rockandrollbeerguy. Get access to some interviews and support the podcast. Support independent art. Cheers.
Crowd.
Yeah, I can tell you're listening, like you're actually drinking. Cheers. I almost cheers with the microphone.
Next thing you gotta do is get some little glass.
Yeah,
so you get that nice clink.
Clink. Citrusy.
That's good.
Like a citrus IPA.
Yeah, it's a bit heavy. I like it.
We're drinking, what is this? Alligator IPA with Mecca grade malted and raw barley. Raw spelt, raw oats, Amarillo, and Simcoe hops. From Brewery West in San Pedro.
Neato.
What's up, everyone? Welcome to the Rock and Roll Beer Guy podcast. I am in the studio. Not my studio. I'm in your studio.
It's my studio.
I'm here with Richard Vreeland. Am I saying that right?
Yeah, you can call me Rich.
Rich Vreeland. And a.k.a. Disasterpeace.
Howdy.
How you doing today?
I'm doing all right. This is a well appreciated reprieve from
work.
Just nonstop working. So. Except for Valentine's Day.
Oh, well, yeah.
Different kind of work.
That's a different kind of work. That's a romantic work. Is it always that busy? Do you have like times where you have downtime of like a month or so where there's no work?
Well, actually this year I took about a month off, which was the first time. Sorry, not this year. Last year.
I took 2018.
I took about a month off. It was the first time I had taken a break like that, probably in, I don't know, probably since I started doing music for a living. I needed a break. I was coming off a really hard project. My first orchestral film score.
That was the...
Under the Silver Lake.
Under the Silver Lake, yep.
Yeah, and I had some personal tragedy. My sister passed away.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that, man.
Yeah, so it was a pretty rough period of time, and I needed to... after that, I like dove into work for a while just to like get my mind off of it, and I was just working a lot, and then at some point, I was like, I need to just take a break.
Yeah, understandable. But, I mean, if you're constantly working and... Obviously, tragedy doesn't help the whole situation. You need to take a break. I mean, otherwise, you'll just work yourself into the ground, right?
I mean, nothing really has any meaning if there's no like thing that you do outside of what you do. Like, it ceases to matter or mean anything after a while. It's like you need some kind of balance. Like, I don't have a lot of balance in my life right now, but I have enough that I can keep doing this.
Yeah, so when you're doing a project like you are now, it's do you have time? Like, you said you were working 12-hour days most of the time. Do you just go straight to bed, or do you have time to like play a game or something? Or
it's not most of the time. People will think I'm crazy. that was a particular project where the deadlines were just really intense, and so I didn't really have a choice. Normally, I would like try to get up early and work until about 5 or 6, and then go home. And like have like a boundary workspace, so basically like not work at home at all, just kind of chill out.
Well, that's good. Do you in that chill out time, are you, because you do work on you've worked on a lot of video games, are you a gamer like on your time off?
It's interesting, like
or has it like run since you work in it, it just kind of you don't want to do it?
Well, I was going to say, it's interesting, like, the way in which my relationship to games over time has changed. I mean, I grew up obsessed with video games. They were, like, magic to me. And I played, it was all I cared about when I was a kid, really. And, I mean, that carried on for a pretty long time. I still play games, but it's changed. I spend so much time playing games that I work on, and I think in the same way that in my music career, like I'm always trying to like find something new and exciting, something that like recontextualizes my work. I think I put a lot of pressure on games to do that for me too. Like it's hard for me to like just play a new game with that sort of mindset. But every once in a while that will happen. Like there's this game called Earth Defense Force. Do you ever play that?
I've heard of it, yes. I haven't played it, but I've heard of it, yeah.
It's so fun. It's like a B-movie in a video game. It's like giant, like, aliens and giant, like, insects.
Is it a strategy type of game? Or
no, it's like running around and blowing shit up
okay,
kind of game. It's ridiculous.
Third person or first person?
I think you can switch between the two.
Okay.
But it's cooperative, and it's just... You run around a city and they're like giant ants, like knocking over buildings. It's the most ridiculous game.
That sounds like fun.
It's very fun. So I have like games like that I like to play. I've been playing ice hockey games since I was like a kid. That's like my. It's like therapy or something weird like that.
Did you play hockey growing up at all? The actual sport? Yeah.
Yeah, I did. Yeah.
That's a rough sport, man. Lots of hits, lots of checks and fights and
on TV. not so much when you're a kid. They don't really let you do that.
Ah,
but
I
actually,
that was all the fun. No, I'm just kidding.
I played for a couple years as an adult, and actually the like the lower the skill level of the players that you're playing with, the more dangerous it is because they don't know how to stop.
Right, so they just smash into you.
You play like a pickup game and they're like people like flying down the ice who don't know how to stop and like crashing into each other.
Yeah. I would be that guy. I don't know how to ice skate. Never. I tried it once, and I just kept falling and falling and falling. I'm like, nope, not for me then.
Well, you'd be okay, because it's like the next tier of, like, beginner. Like, the first tier is, like, you hug the boards, you kind of waddle around, you fall over, you get up. But then, like, once you figure out how to, like...
stay on your feet.
Skate and pick up speed, that's when you're, like, the most dangerous, because you know how to go fast, but you don't know how to...
Stop
or turn.
Oh man, I mean, the closest I got was roller blading, not ice skating, but roller blading, and I ended up breaking my ankle doing that. Like my left ankle, just my whole foot just went the other direction instead of, you know, where it's supposed to be, and I dropped straight down onto it and just tore all the ligaments and broke everything. It was just like, nah, maybe I just don't need wheels on my feet. Yeah, wheels or blades or anything, just walking.
Was that your last attempt at skating of any kind?
Yeah. Yeah, that was the last. I'm like, nah, I'm good. I don't need to be. And as I get older, it just gets, you know, your body gets a little more brittle. So I don't want to break anything that'll be permanently damaged. Because, you know, as a kid, it broke, but, you know, it healed because you're young and your body heals itself. And
yeah.
But now I feel like I'm 37. If I fall and break my ankle, like I think I'm done walking for a while.
I don't think you're giving yourself enough credit.
Yeah, right.
I mean, like, there are like professional athletes who come back from
professional
breaks.
Athletes have very expensive medical help, surgery.
Yeah, but most of it is just exercise, I think.
That's true. Yeah, stretching, yoga, and all that stuff really does help.
Not being dumb.
I've been working on that as I get older, just not being dumb. I used to, you know, when I was telling you I was in a band for a while, and it was my obsession to just, you know, jump off stage and
wash
and, you know, climb things and make a show out of it. But I'd end up doing dumb things that hurt.
And you were really getting into it. You were raging on stage.
I was raging. It was like, I was influenced by like all the crazy punk bands, and that was my thing. So as I got older, I'm like, kind of wish I hadn't done those things. Like, I feel them now. You know, you feel it in the joints.
Were you a drummer or guitar player?
Singer. Front man, which I still want to do music to this day, but I don't want to be a front man ever again.
Why is that?
It's too much pressure. It's too much pressure to entertain, because a lot of people, they look at the front man as like, you know, the entertainment.
It's like the president of the band.
Right. You know, and some front men let that get to their head, and, you know, they try not, like, I guess the common thing is that the front man doesn't help the band load up the equipment and all that stuff.
Oh, right, because they're too
busy being
prissy.
Yeah.
Their hands are part of their appeal, so you can't.
Yeah, if I do, which I do want to, if I do start more music in a band situation, like I do a lot of home studio projects and stuff, but if I were to do a live thing, I want to be bass.
Live bass.
Live bass is fun. You get in the groove with the drummer, and it just feels nice. Do you play instruments? I mean, obviously you play instruments, but
you're
aside from
the
keyboards and the guitar, do you play a bass? Do you know how to play drums?
I mean, I can play bass in the way that any guitar player can badly play bass. I can play drums, not well, but
you can keep a beat.
Well, I can keep a beat. I play goofy style or open handed.
Okay.
It's because I never learned the right way. But you know.
Can you improvise? Like, do you jam, as the kids say? You want to jam?
Yeah, I can jam.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah, I mean, because that's how I write music. So
you write it. So I
improvise just really slowly.
Yeah, man. It's improvising is something that I've never been able to explain to people. When I used to have group sessions of people would come over and just grab an instrument and just do something, and then and cool stuff would happen, terrible things would happen that were really bad for the ears. But for the most part, it was just being in the pocket with a group of people has always been something I've been attracted to, just being able to hit a like a frequency with someone.
Yeah. You know? It's like a social activity, even though you're not talking. It's like there's some sort of exchange.
Which is, and we don't even communicate verbally. You just look at each other. Good. And, you know, how do you, I guess, deal with it? Because most of what you do is a solo project. I mean, you collaborate with a lot of people, but
yeah,
I mean, for example, like the Fez soundtrack, that's all you, right? Most of the part? Most
yeah,
of
it? It's all me. Yeah. Yeah.
So I have a hard time with solo projects because I get like perfectionist mentality where like you don't, it's never done. How do you deal with that kind of pressure for, you know, it's all on your shoulders, you know?
Sometimes it's hard. I mean, I think I think I've just gotten into the, I've developed an ability to have an intuition about when something is done. I think part of it is just, it's personality driven. It's like what's good enough for you personally. And I try to, I mean, I don't know if I try to do this, but you know, I have a certain like bar or standard that I set for myself, and I usually just work at something until I reach that bar, unless I run out of time. And then I just, you know, do as the best I can.
Right, yeah. It's a little different once you get to the level you're at now where you have all these projects coming at you and you have deadlines and stuff.
Yeah.
When it's like I'm just jamming at home.
Right. Well, that's actually a good point because one of the things about doing commission-based work is it forces you to get into a deadline sort of mentality about what you're doing, which is, I think it's really valuable because... you know, your time is finite and I've had the same problem doing original material where you don't have any externally imposed timelines. So you can kind of just, you can keep working on it forever.
Keep adding layers.
Yeah. So it's nice to have, some sort of structure that like actually grounds what you're doing in reality. Right. And you're not like, I could work on this forever and, you know, eventually it'll be good enough.
Yeah, I feel that it's important. Like, some people want to say that art should not be restricted in any way, but I don't know. I guess if you're going to do something for yourself, then yes, don't restrict yourself, but...
Yeah. Well, there's no right way to do it either, right? I mean, there's nothing wrong with, like, working on something and then, like, not working on it for, like, 20 years.
And then going back to it.
Or, like, releasing something and saying it's done and then, like, going back 10 years later and, like, changing it. You can do that. I mean,
yeah.
People will maybe, they might get mad at you, but that doesn't mean that it's like immoral or bad or the wrong thing to do. I mean, it's all art. It's all interesting.
Yeah. It's funny that you mentioned that people get mad, and it's so hilarious when I hear that people get upset at bands for remastering something or changing something. And it's like, man, it's not
people
yours.
Are possessive. It's not even really about quality a lot of the time. It's just about feeling like you get attached to the way something is, and it starts to feel like a part of you or like it belongs to you in some way. And so when it changes, it like, you know, it's you have cognitive dissonance about it.
Yeah, that's a strange thing. Like when it goes for music or even other things like games or TV shows or something like that, where if it's something that's not very well known and you discover it for yourself and then you're like... It becomes popular, and you're like, ugh, now everybody knows about it. I don't like it anymore. Like, that's just strange to me. But
yeah, it is interesting. Yeah, I think that is interesting. It like the context of it has changed. It's like maybe there's a strong memory associated with it. Like I had that experience with Muse.
Oh
the
yeah,
band Muse.
Yeah,
I had a friend of mine. Well, he wasn't really a friend. When I was a teenager, I used to do like graphic design and websites for people, like online, and someone from England sent me this album, Origin of Symmetry. Mm-hmm. It was right around the time it came out in England, and they hadn't really blown up in the States yet.
Yeah,
and I think it would be another like year or something like that.
Yeah, they kind of blew up with Absolution, I think, here.
Yeah. So I was like, this album is so cool, and then you know, then they got big here, and I was like, It's just a weird, there's a something weird about it. Like,
yeah. Yeah. I mean, I kind of get it. I get like that with certain things, but I try to talk myself down and like, it's not mine. It's their project.
Yeah.
Like with Muse, for example, like I love the first I love that album that you mentioned, Origin Symmetry, and Absolution. I still think is, you know,
yeah, it's a good album.
I think it's a great album.
But then they kind of turned into Coldplay or something.
Yeah, well, even Coldplay, like
their first album is great.
Yeah, Coldplay was amazing, and then it kind of turned into this pop thing. Like
their second album's pretty good too.
Yeah,
but then after that, it's like
once it starts getting into like dance pop, I was just like, well, now you're a completely different band. Like, I can't follow, you know?
Yeah, because they go from, like, it goes from being this more sort of raw expression of, you know, what they're doing, becomes this more, like, polished, like, accessible to the masses kind of content. And I think it loses some of the
artistic value.
It just loses the innocence of it, or their relationship has changed to what they're doing. And so I feel like it comes out in the music.
Yeah, when it becomes like you're doing it for money as opposed to you're doing it because you love doing it. And I'm not saying that that's the case for these people. They might love pop music. And it's
it's a part of it. I mean, it's...
Yeah, it's within their right. That's their what they want to do. If that's what they want to do,
they're seizing an opportunity.
Yeah.
So
I've done stuff that my elitist, hardcore friends would frown upon. You know, I took a paycheck.
It seems like an oxymoron.
Right.
Yeah. Elitist hardcore.
Elitist hardcore. but it's a thing. It's a thing. Like my buddies, Poison the Well, like they're one of those bands that their fan base kind of turned on them when they got a little more. They didn't go pop, but they went more melodic. There was more singing. It was less punk hardcore and more evolved, more mature sound. And people were like, no, I want you to be an angry 18-year-old. You know what I mean?
People have complicated relationships to change. Like, people want things to be immutable. Like, you experience it once and you want to feel like you know what it is.
Yeah.
But bands are people, and they're people are moving targets. They're not immutable objects.
Yeah. And no matter how grandiose you make it in your mind, like, sometimes certain bands just become like untouchable in your brain. Like, you know how people talk about Radiohead, Radiohead is God, or Beatles, or anything like that, where they're just bigger than themselves in your mind, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I wanted to ask you.
No gods, as your hat says.
As my hat says. There is a... I know this is probably Wikipedia'd, but what's up with your name? Like, Disasterpeace. It's a really cool name.
Thank you.
I am I'm jealous.
You got to get your own.
Because I like it brings, you know, disaster and peace. It's because it's not a piece as a piece of paper. It's a piece as an inner piece.
Yep.
Is that a representation of yourself and your mind? Like, are you?
It would be easy to like rationalize it later, but the truth is, I know it about it is that I wanted to start a band when I was like 17 or 18, and I liked, you know, plays on words. So I was messing around with that, and I came up with Disasterpeace, which was like a play on masterpiece. And then I found out that there was, at some point, I found out that there was like a Slipknot song called Disasterpeace.
Yes.
So I changed peace to peace, like peace sign, peace.
I like it. It's kind of a duality, you know, kind of a thing where you have both sides of the anger and, you know, destruction and peace and happiness and whatnot.
Yeah, duality.
Duality.
Which was a really like big...
Which is another really big Slipknot song.
It was a big... it was a big element of my music and stuff like when I was young, when I was like starting. Like I was really into the idea of duality. Like going between like two chords or two vibes or whatever. And then like over time I kind of got less into that particular idea and more into like other things. But
yeah,
it's a good name. And it's hard to like... I feel fortunate that I picked something cool that I still like 15 years later or whatever.
Yeah.
Because, you know, a name like that has a momentum to it if you keep using it.
Sure.
So it's
easier. It sounds like it's a thing. You know what I mean? Like, if you are not familiar with your work at all and you just say, hey, Disasterpeace, you read it, you see it on a piece of paper, you're like, that's got to be a thing, right? That's a band, that's a project, that's a movie, that's got to be something. And that's kind of how what happened with the rock and roll beer guy thing. Like, it's such a silly, cheesy thing, but it works. Like,
it rolls off the tongue in a nice way.
Yeah, you hear it and you're like, oh, that's got to be a thing, right? It's not? All right,
sounds
I'll
like a nationally syndicated program.
Welcome to the rock and roll beer guy. Yeah,
a Sirius XM show.
How did you, so you keep mentioning that, you know, you started at an early age and you wanted to be in a band. Like, what got you into music? Because you were working in graphic design. Like, how did you make that transition from, like, my buddy, one of my best friends from high school, he was doing graphic design with me. We were both doing it. And I branched off and did music, and he now owns a company where that's all he does. He just makes signs for Red Bull, and like he prints out all the, you know, materials for them and everything. So what made you switch to music?
Well, I think part of it was like I didn't want to just work for companies, like doing like logos and like branding and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Like, but it was more about music. It was more about my passion for music. Like, I was always interested in both. I got into graphic design earlier in my life because it was more accessible to me, like drawing, and like I used to make like fake company logos, and my mom was a graphic designer, so I was around that. But I was also around music, but I was just, it was a little harder for me to get into that because it was more, I don't know, maybe it felt more technical or something to me, except for like, you know, I would like bang on the drums or whatever because my stepfather was a music director at our church, so we'd have like band practice in the basement.
Okay.
But yeah, so I mean, I got into graphic design when I was like 11, 12. I started messing around with like my mom's computer, making like newsletters and shit like that, and I didn't get into music really until high school. Okay. But I've been around music since I was young, so I had a lot of like pent up creative energy.
And the music you were around, was it, what kind of style was it, like jazzy? Like, I mean, obviously, you're saying church, they do a lot, was it like gospel? Or
yeah, but it wasn't like good gospel, it was just like church stuff.
It wasn't like the crazy gospel drummers that you see out
in
the
NAM. It wasn't like a Baptist, you know, it wasn't like any crazy, like, soulful kind of stuff. It was just like whatever, but, you know, my stepfather was also a very talented musician. He had his own music, and he had a Beatles cover band, and so we listened to a lot of Beatles, and listened to a lot of like Vince Guaraldi, like around Christmas time.
All right.
Jazz trio. My mom was really, both my mom and my dad actually were really into George Winston. It was like new age piano music. Okay. Classic rock. Like, my stepfather was into Led Zeppelin. My dad was into Queen. So, you know, this
did
is
you,
kind of
did
stuff
you go
was,
to school for like playing the piano? Like, did you take piano lessons and all of that, or did you just kind of picked it up?
I took guitar lessons actually.
Guitar lessons
in high school. Yeah. And then I went to Berklee College of Music and but I was never like, I'm not a great like traditional musician. Like, I've never been great at it.
Do you read sheet music and stuff like that, or
really slowly? Like, it takes me a while, but I can read it. I'm not a sight reader.
Yeah, neither am I. I even took classes, and I just couldn't pick it up. Like, I know what they are. I know, I can tell you, yeah, that's that and quarter note and whatever. But ultimately, I'm more of the, let's just pick up an instrument and this is what I want it to sound like. And all of our band practices were more like, hey, instead of doing the da 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 there, just do more of like a, you know, da da da, you know, like,
right,
pretty much how we went with it. Instead of, and our drummer hated it because he was a school teacher. Like, he taught music.
Yeah.
So he'd be like, can you tell me the key, the chord, like anything? I'm like, I don't know.
I would love to be able to sight read. Yeah. I feel like a lot of people, there are a lot of people who sight read, but they can't improvise, or vice versa. Mm-hmm. And obviously there are people who can do both, but it would be great to be able to like do both and like have them feel like a single process in your brain.
Yeah.
But for me, like when I'm sight reading, I'm like in a totally different mindset. I feel like I'm a machine or something. Like, I'm translating.
Yeah, well, it's basically kind of code. It's just dots and lines and stuff, you know?
Yeah, it's like an abstract language.
Yeah, it's weird. And it's, you know, the universal language and all that. So you can always communicate with someone through music. You did the Under the Silver Lake with a orchestra. How did that work out, since you're not, you know, as proficient in writing out all the, like, every note for every piece of instrument? Like, how did that work out in your brain? Like, how do you approach that?
It was really hard. I mean, the story that I've been telling is like generally when I do a new project, I try to pick out a couple of areas where I feel like I can grow as an artist and do something new. And it's like a an incremental step forward for me. But that was like a giant leap, like as far as how difficult it was and how many new skills I had to pick up. It was really hard. I had a ton of help, and it was still really hard. I mean, I had to figure out how to prepare music for an orchestra and not necessarily take it the whole way. Like I kind of decided pretty quickly that I didn't want to, dedicate a ton of energy to like learning how to
play the flute.
Yes. Or, you know, doing like music notation or like, even like getting really deep into orchestration. I wanted to just focus primarily on writing and understanding enough about the instruments to make intelligent choices about how to write for them generally, and then hire someone who spent like their entire life doing this stuff, because, you know, I would never be as good as they are at doing that. And there's plenty of things for me to chew on. I don't need to chew on that.
For sure, man. And it, you know, sometimes it's needed. Like, you look at a lot of people that write books, a lot of the times, like, they have people assisting them writing the book itself. Like, yeah. They have the story, the concept, and everything about it, the dialogue, but then they need someone to actually kind of put it together.
Right.
And, you know, for a project like that, which is so complicated with so many different pieces, like, it's, I mean, you know, props to you, man. I would have given up. Nope, that's too much work.
It was a lot of, I mean, there were many days when I wanted to quit. Most of the hard projects that I've done, there have been days where I wanted to quit, like End of the Silver Lake, Hyperlight Drifter. It Follows wasn't too bad.
I recently did
a Netflix project that was like that too, where it was difficult. Let me get a paper towel.
When I do want to ask you, and I'll do this slowly. Yeah. When you're working on something like that, like a movie or a game, how do you get to watch the movie, play the game before you start writing the music, or is it something that you just kind of have an idea and then you kind of make it work out together? I mean, do you get any kind of build? Of like a movie build before, I don't know how that works out.
Generally, yes. When I was first starting, I was working on some projects where the music is kind of an afterthought. You know, it wasn't really that important, and so it's more common in those circumstances to not be getting like an actual copy of what you're. Like the larger project while you're working on it. So whether it's a game and getting a build or a movie or whatever. So like when I first started, I worked on some games where I didn't even get like a build of the game at any point until, you know, like I didn't really see the music in context until the game came out. Like I would just get like screenshots.
Wow. That's
it sucked.
Yeah, it's gotta be rough.
Well, I mean, it's there's something about it that's oddly nice because you don't have to it prevents you from overthinking it, but it also prevents you from being particular about how it actually
how
feels
it flows,
and how it works in context. So it's a, you know, it's a good and bad kind of thing. But after those couple of early experiences, I made a very strong decision that like I was never gonna do that again. Like I was always gonna try to be as involved as I felt like I needed to be successful.
Yeah, I can't imagine, even for like Fez, for example, where I feel the sound of it, of the music, plays a part in the story of the actual game. You know what I mean? I don't know if you had a copy of that before you, when you worked on it.
Yeah, I did.
Okay. So that makes sense, you know, because it flows perfectly with what's going on in the game. And I would imagine there might be some kind of clashing of just overall feeling or emotion if you're not aware of where it's heading. You know, if somebody just gives you a screenshot and then you have this thought of like, maybe it'll be a darker tone or more of a horror-sounding type of thing or a happy-sounding thing, and it clashes with what's actually happening. I don't know, man. That's rough.
Yeah.
I know you do a lot of chiptune kind of retro-sounding 8-bit, 16-bit-sounding music.
I have.
Is that your preference when you're writing?
No. I mean, that's kind of where I came from, so a lot of my projects in the... probably I would say the first half of my career were related to that. They were inspired by that retro video game music. And even in that sort of narrow space, I always felt like I found ways to do things differently. So, you know, I did projects where it was like authentic sounding like NES style music or music.
Like the Bitrunner stuff, I think the retro stages was very
That. Or doing like something I did a Game Boy like inspired one, or you know, I've done like FM synthesis, which is like a particular type of electronic sound. So I was always trying to find ways to, like, even though it was like a narrow sort of territory, find new things to do. And even like in those early years, I was also doing like chiptune stuff as Disasterpeace, but I was doing work for hire kind of stuff as Rich, just as me, as my name, Rich Vreeland. Like I worked on a couple of Telltale games before they closed down and different kinds of stuff where I got to do something other than chiptunes. So there's always been that interest for me and like, you know, to do different kinds of stuff. But that's just where I started.
So what would you say are some of your bigger influences for that particular sound? Like, what were some of the games that you grew up with that you were like fascinated? Like for me, a lot of the Contra, Castlevania, Mega Man, those are the games that kind of just rung in my brain with that sound. I'm sorry, I just poured us a double scatterbrain DDH.
Tastes like cheese.
With Citra. Who is this brewery? I got a shout out to my buddy JR. He sent me this from Georgia. Who are these people? Bearded Iris.
I like cheese.
Out of Nashville, Tennessee. I haven't even tasted it. It smells nice. Oh, wow. Yeah. I can see the cheesiness. It's the fermentation. You know, it's the same process, really, as creating cheese. But as I was saying, so some of the games that I grew up with, that like the music kind of sticks with me, and growing up, like I'll show friends of mine that don't play games, I'll be like, dude, check out like early Castlevania music, early Contra music. It's metal or even classic, like classical music, but just with the sound, you know, being broken down. What were some of your favorites growing up?
I loved Castlevania. Let me think. I really liked... I think it was more of a general sort of aesthetic. Mm-hmm. Than like a lot of specific like soundtracks, but there are certainly ones that I really liked. Like I really liked Marble Madness.
Oh my god, I love that soundtrack.
It was just so unique.
It was such a hard game.
Very hard. Very unique soundtrack. Little Nemo Dream Master.
Oh yeah,
great music.
Yeah, that's a good one.
I liked Mario. I don't know.
I mean, it's classic.
There's just something about it. The simplicity of it, the sort of it has like an edge to it. Like it almost sounds distorted in a weird way.
Yeah.
Which was kind of cool. I always liked that sound. And I think because it sounded distorted, but the voices were separated, you could do very complex like harmonic stuff, which you can't easily do in like, you know, on one guitar going through it, like an amp, a distorted amp. Because it just sounds like mush, so you're kind of limited a little bit more in what you can do. So, it was kind of my introduction to like counterpoint and like how to work with like lots of voices at the same time and like, you know, figure out how to make chord progressions. And
that's awesome, man.
It really puts the focus on composition. That's what I think. That's why. That's part of what
draws you into
drew
that.
Drew me to it, and what kept me doing that style for a long time. Like, when I was starting, you know, before I got into that, I was just recording guitars and, like, trying to make rock kind of stuff. and I was struggling to like get the production to a point place where I liked it, because I didn't know what the hell I was doing. I didn't know how to use a compressor or any EQ or any of that kind of stuff. But then I stumbled into Chiptunes, where I didn't really have to make a lot of those kind of decisions. I mean, there's a certain like production to just using whatever, but it's much more about arrangement and like picking the right notes and stuff like that. So I kind of front loaded my career with like just focusing on like mostly composition. And then like over time I got more and more into production as I like, you know, got older and could like comprehend this stuff better.
Well, yeah. And your career takes off. You can afford to get better gear. That is such an important aspect of being able to create what you want to create, is just having the correct gear, the stuff you need to accomplish it. You know, you can always mishmash with whatever, you know, if you really want to, you can figure it out with like a microphone and some instruments, but more access to like what you have right now here, this setup, I mean, it's fantastic. So
yeah, but it's also very minimal, and I could write a lot of the stuff that I do now with this setup I could have done like 10 years ago. I mean, it's obviously, you know, I have more at my disposal as far as like sounds and experience and stuff like that, but really, I mean, a set of tools, however limited it is, it's all in the eye of the beholder. It's like it can be a detriment, it could be a negative thing, or it can be like an opportunity to like really dive into a particular avenue, because you don't really have a lot of, people don't have like a ton of bandwidth to like comprehend like this massive possibility space that is like making stuff. So when you have limitations, it helps you to focus and like pick, to make decisions about what you're actually going to do. It like helps you actually make something.
Right. Yeah. It goes back to what we were saying about having deadlines and stuff like that. If you're doing like a project like a Fez, you know that you're going to stick to that world of,
you figure out the sound,
yeah,
and then you have a rule set, and it makes it easier to write music in that rule set, because you're not worrying about reinventing every wheel every time.
So if you had a fantasy project or a dream project that you would do, what would that look like? Would it be a game or a movie or kind of like,
I don't know,
a concert?
People ask me that question a lot, and I always struggle to answer it, because I dream about not working, because I have a lot of, I've been working like nonstop since like, I don't know, like the last 8 or 9, 10 years. So I mean, I'm fortunate in that way. Like, I'm not like pining for opportunities or anything like that. So I think that's probably why I have a hard time answering that question.
Okay. Obviously, the dream is to not work, I think, and just enjoy life. I would love that as well.
But it's not even that. It's like I never want to not work. I think I fantasize about not feeling like stress all the time and feeling like I'm working too much.
Okay.
Just like having more, being able to like
more freedom, I guess.
Chill out, and like if I'm like, oh, you know, I'm gonna take a couple hours and like just go do something, hang out or whatever, and it's not like I'm not like worrying about some,
sure, yeah,
deadline or something.
It's
like
a constant struggle for everyone, I think, to maybe not everyone. I know some lazy ass people.
me too.
I'm one of those that I always have to be doing something. Like, this is my weekend. Friday and Saturday is my weekend. I work Sundays, and I did a podcast at 6:30 this morning.
Wow.
With Danny from Cradle of Filth, because he's in England. So it's like I have to get up. And
so you flew to England.
I flew to England, came back. Yeah. No, I had to get up, and I'm like, oh, good morning. And he's like, oh, it's actually afternoon for me. And I'm like, fuck. That's why we're doing it this early. But yeah, I always try to keep myself busy, it's been since I moved out to LA, I haven't been doing the music thing. So I'm starting to feel that itch of like, I need to be doing music. I'm not being productive, you know, and that's why I do more episodes. Like, I did 2 or 3 episodes of the podcast on the weekend, because I'll feel like I'm producing something, as opposed to, you know, when I had the band, it was band practice. That was my free time.
Right.
You know, go band practice, go play a show, you know, go on tour, you know, whatever, keep you busy. But I guess that's just for people that are in the music world. That's just the way it is, right? You have to keep your mind active. I don't know. Does that work for you that way? You have to. You're saying you fantasize about not having to stress out, but I feel that if you were to take a month off,
you'd
still be freaking out. Like, I need to do something.
Well, yeah, I can't just sit around and do nothing for like more than 2 days. Then I'm like, I'll find something to do.
Yeah.
Like, it'll be something different than what I normally do. Like, you know, I have, you know, I'll pick up a hobby or, you know, I have like some side projects that I like to mess with. Like I've been making like little like music trinkets, like software trinkets for like the last couple years when I don't have time to do, like when I have time. Sorry.
When you say trinkets, you mean like plugins for like maybe?
Like, yeah, like MIDI, tools, like MIDI plugins. Primarily.
So are you designing the sounds for these things, like creating a sound?
It's MIDI, so it's just notes.
Okay.
And like data about that you would use to control music.
Okay.
So like, you know.
Well, okay, so you mean physical trinkets?
No, like software.
I don't know, I'm confused. How does that work?
So like basically it's like a plugin but for MIDI. So before you actually get to the audio part,
you're just writing notes,
manipulating the actual notes that go into the, like, say, like, your DAW, like, Pro Tools or Logic or whatever. So, like an arpeggiator, would be an example of a MIDI effect or plugin.
Okay. Okay, yeah, okay.
It takes an input of note data, and then it outputs something.
Kind of one of the things that I have always been not informed about is, like, bit crushing, stuff like that for MIDI. As well, like, is that one of the things that
Bit crushing is DSP. It's an audio effect, so okay. It's affecting the audio, not the MIDI.
Okay, so
MIDI is like it's music data. It's like it's not sound. It's just ones and it's just like instructions on how to play,
like
an
dots
instrument.
On the sheet music. Like, but
exactly,
not,
it's like the digital equivalent of sheet music.
Okay,
yeah,
because I had one of my buddies. Plays guitar in this band called Human Abstract. They're not around anymore, but he would show me the music he was working. He would write all his music on MIDI.
Yeah.
And then learn it on the guitar and play it live.
Interesting.
And he would send me the files, and it sounded like 8-bit notes because it was just 8 bits playing the notes like do 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 do.
Right, because it was just MIDI files.
Yeah, yeah.
So it was very primitive sounds.
Yeah. So to get extra nerdy, because I'm not a big. I love music, and it's been a part of my life my whole life, but I've never gotten deep into like software and whatnot. So what are you using when it comes to create music? Just obviously MIDI, but what programs are you using?
I use Logic Pro.
Is that better than Pro Tools for you?
For writing music, it is. I think for audio editing, it's Pro Tools is like the industry standard. Mm-hmm. It's a preference, and it has... Depending on what kind of audio editing you're doing, it has certain features that people swear by. People who do post-production and stuff like that. I don't do a lot of post-production. Well, I guess I kind of do. But I'm not doing, like... I'm not editing, like, voiceover and, like, dialogue replacement. Like, 15,000 files at a time. So I'm less concerned with those sort of features, maybe. But I don't like Pro Tools that much. I like Logic, so...
I don't like Pro Tools, but I've been using it for so long now that it's my go-to. I feel that that's where I edit the podcast.
It gets the job done.
Yeah, it's definitely very simple, you know, and it has the ability to, you could, you know, plug a MIDI into it, a MIDI controller, and do certain things, but I've always had a hard time, like, creating beats on it. I can't. I just don't know how to do it.
Some people swear by it. Some, like there are, like, some very professional people who use it for music, but... It's not a particularly large audience, although I'm sure it will continue to grow because it's just such a widespread piece of software.
Yeah.
Especially in film.
Do you have the desire anymore to actually do a band? Because you said you wanted to be in a band when you were younger. Has that idea ever been, like, do you want to play keyboards in a band or guitar in a band?
I would, yeah. I think about it sometimes because I was never really in a proper band. Like, as a teenager, I had some friends that I used to jam with. Mm-hmm. And when I was a young adult, like maybe like 25, 26, I was in this one band that formed just to play one show for like a benefit concert or something. And so we got together for like 2 months and wrote like 5 or 6 songs and played once, and that was it. And it was kind of cool. it was a good experience.
If you were to start a band now, like, what would you want to do music style wise?
Something really energetic. It's where I could just kind of go crazy. I think that's what I probably need personally. Like, I would, because I'm already like a professional musician, I would probably want a band to be like an outlet for me, like a way to let it like blow off steam.
Okay.
It would be like therapeutic, I think. So
heavier
I would,
music or just
it doesn't have to be happy. It just has to be like energetic.
Energetic.
So like jumping around, fast, wild. I mean, like the band that my favorite band is probably Deerhoof.
Okay.
I love Deerhoof.
Yeah. So that's kind of a join a band. What band would that be? So.
Probably Deerhoof.
Yeah.
But they don't need me. They have plenty of people in that band.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. Just I love the complexity. It's such a great example of like a band that is very, very tight and very like technically proficient, but also very, very raw and loose at the same time. It's like a very weird combo. Like it's just I don't know. I don't feel like there are a lot of bands like that I know of that just have that sensibility.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, there's some, I have a hard time trying to get certain people to listen to stuff that I listen to that I feel that way about, that they're complex, but some, like, for example, one of my favorite bands is the Dillinger Escape Plan.
Yeah.
And a lot of people
don't like that.
Don't like it. They automatically, they hear noise. It's just loud and noise.
Yeah.
But I my brain breaks it down to where I hear jazz out of that music. You know what I mean? And I try to explain that to people, and they just don't. They don't grasp it, I guess.
What would you, what album or where would you recommend people start? Because I could never get into that band.
Ooh, I definitely wouldn't start where I started. I started with their first one, the Calculating... Well, actually, before that, like Under the Running Board EP stuff, but honestly, their newest one, I feel like they finally figured it out. They finally figured out what they're trying to do and polished it, and it's their last one because they broke up.
Oh, okay.
And they brought in all of the different elements of their sound into one album, I think, in that, because throughout the years they evolved, they did more singing too, like it happens to a lot of bands, like they don't, you know, you get older, you're not as angry, you have a decent life and partner, and like, all right, well, you know, I'm not as mad. So I feel that I would say the last one, Dissociation would be a good way to play as a place to start, because they do a lot of, like I said, jazzy type of elements.
Sure.
If you can kind of tune out the distorted guitars and the screaming, which I'm a fan of, but I get it. You can break it down and appreciate the structure of the music itself, and it's nuts.
I'll give it a shot. I mean, I'm not opposed to screaming or distortion.
Have you ever considered doing concerts for your stuff?
I did concerts for about 8 years.
Oh, you did? Okay.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. How
it never got it never got big. I only did like a handful every couple week. I mean, I do like maybe, I don't know, 15, 20 shows a year or something.
Okay. How was that set up? Did you have other musicians or was it just you?
When I started, it was just me, and I was playing with backing tracks, guitar. I was playing guitar to backing tracks. And then I had a drummer for like 4 years or something like that. And we, it was still backing tracks, but I pulled the drums out. And then I took a little detour/foray into writing solo piano music with vocals, and I did a couple shows doing that, but I never really felt great doing that, so I kind of stopped.
Interesting. I mean, I think it'd be a cool experience to have some of your like game soundtracks and movie soundtracks with like some of the visual in the background.
It's happened.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was a Red Bull concert in United Kingdom for It Follows.
Oh, nice!
A couple years ago, but I didn't do it because I didn't want to. But I was like, I would love for it to happen. So, you know, let's find let's find a band that wants to do it.
Interesting. And would you, are you thinking about maybe doing that in the future, doing like a little tour of some of your works? Or
I don't think so. I mean, maybe. Yeah. I don't know. I never really liked performing that much. Right. It's a ton of work for, if it was music that was designed to be played live, like I would do it, but to retrofit like studio music for live is a lot of work. It's a lot of prepping for it's live shows are kind of like a one and done kind of thing, unless you're like building up the momentum to do a tour, like to do a bunch of shows. Otherwise you're spending weeks practicing for like an hour or 2 hours of content or whatever, and then that's it. So that was always my issue with it, because it was never a priority for me. So the opportunity would come along to like do a show, and I'd have to stop what I was doing and like just practice for like 2 weeks, play a show, still be like, oh, that could have been better. and then I have to go back to whatever I was doing. And so I'd have to relearn everything the next time. So it was hard.
Yeah, I can imagine. I mean, it's a lot of pieces to synchronize, and yet then the machine and, you know, backing tracks are, I guess, I wouldn't say flawless, but it's a backing track. And then it's on you. There's the pressure's on you to keep up with that backing track. You know what I mean?
Yeah. When you're by yourself, it's not the same as like being with a group. Like, yeah, there's less attention on you when you're in a group, I think, unless you're the singer, like you said.
Right. Right. Yeah.
Or, you know,
I don't think we talked about that on mic, but yeah, I don't want to be a front man anymore. I feel there's too much pressure to entertain, you know?
Yeah.
In the front. But, what are your thoughts on the, I feel that video game music as a whole just doesn't get the recognition that it should, you know? Mm-hmm. Like I'm some of my favorite composers are in the video game realm. Like Nobu Uematsu is one of my favorites, and
yeah,
you know, they don't get that love that certain like Clint Mansell's or Hans Zimmer mm-hmm. would get, you know? Like,
yeah,
you don't see Nobu performing at Coachella.
No, but he has a huge following.
Well, he does.
It's just a different audience. It's just a different, not a different audience necessarily, but a different, it's presented in a different way, I guess.
Hmm.
Like in the media and stuff like that.
Can you talk about any of the stuff you're working on?
A little bit. I've been working with Heart Machine on a game for a little while.
That's nice.
The studio that I worked on Hyperlight Drifter with. Right. And I just did a Netflix movie that's coming out soon.
Can you say the name? Do you know the name? Unnamed Project Number One Netflix?
It's called Triple Frontier.
Triple Frontier, okay.
I'm working on a theater project in New York, which is interesting. It's a new sort of territory for me.
Interesting. How would that go? Like theater.
Well, it's
project.
Not like a play. It's like a. It's like a. It's like a. It's one of these kind of shows where you. It's like, not just a stage. It's like a. It's like a, almost like being in a video game. It's like multiple floors, lots of rooms. You kind of walk through the space. It's almost like writing for an installation, but it's
okay.
But it's also a play. So it's different.
That's interesting.
Never done anything like that before.
I don't think I've ever heard of anything like that before. That sounds interesting.
Yeah, I don't think I had either, except in like some movies. Like, what's that movie? Synecdoche, New York. Synecdoche, New York.
I've
Charlie Kaufman movie Philip Seymour Hoffman, where he's like a playwright, and he has a play that takes place in a warehouse, and it's like a building, and you like go through the building, and there's like different actors in the building. And
what?
You should.
I didn't look that
check
up.
Check it out.
Yeah, that sounds super interesting, man. Like,
it's different.
I remember one of the weirdest things I've seen was the Craymaster cycle out in New York and the Guggenheim.
What is that?
So, I forget his name, but he was married to Bjork.
Okay.
And it was like an art installation / music project / performing arts thing where. The Guggenheim, you know, I don't know if you've ever been there, it has like multiple floors, mm-hmm. and each floor was a different cycle of like from, I guess, from the testicles, sperm building to, you know, sex to birth of a person, all the way at the top, you know, of the building. And it was just like a weird performance art. They were wearing crazy costumes. There was a lady with no legs that had like fake legs that were glass attached to her half legs. I don't know what the proper terminology is, but mm-hmm. It was just super. I don't fully understand it, but I've seen it a few times. I saw it live there at the Guggenheim, and it's that to me was fascinating because I don't even know how to describe it to people. It's music, it's art, it's dance, it's sound.
Were you free to move through it at your own pace?
Not at your own pace. It was like a thing.
It was like a set thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Was it live music or pre-recorded?
Pre-recorded at that point. Yeah, but
interesting.
Yeah, I mean it's live sounding, but it's not live instruments.
This is a little bit like that, but different.
Well, I'm interested in looking that up. I mean, it seems very interesting and unique. Let's see some rapid fire questions for you.
Shoot.
What are your thoughts on the Battle Royale fad that's happening in video games right now? Are you a fan of that at all?
It seems fun. I haven't really played any.
You haven't played any at all?
No, I'm aware of the games.
I feel like everybody is doing it. Like, I just yesterday played Battle Royale Tetris.
Battle Royale Tetris?
Yes. So you...
That's
you,
different.
You have the... It's called Tetris 99 and...
You
have your
that.
Tetris screen, and then there's 99 other people or 98 other people around you, and you're trying to see who survives the longest. Yeah. I like that a lot because it's different. You're not running around killing things, but it does feel weird that I feel, you know.
It seems kind of arbitrary.
Yeah, the gaming industry is gravitating towards it. Games like Fortnite and
PUBG
and Blackout now with Call of Duty, and they just keep making them, and everybody seems to be wanting to go in that direction.
I'm sure it will pass.
I don't know. I hope. I mean, I hope.
Or maybe it will just become a mainstay, like FPS multiplayer. Yeah.
I feel that it could be its own thing, and just have maybe one or two games that are really good at it.
And there are games that are like incorporating it as just a mode,
right?
Like Red Dead has a battle royale.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, it's kind of cool. I guess I like the concept that people want to play together more.
As a wrestling fan, I there's an appeal in it for me.
Oh, you just ruined this entire podcast because the next hour of this will be pro wrestling talk.
Oh no!
Tell me. No. What do you mean when you're a wrestling fan? What are you talking about?
growing up, my dad was into wrestling, and he used to have like tapes of pay per views from the 80s. And so I used to watch like old like SummerSlam 87 and like shit like this.
Nice.
Royal Rumble 91 or whatever. He had like a bunch of these tapes and I used to like sit and just watch them over and over again.
Do you keep up with the newer stuff?
No, I when I was a teenager, I got really into wrestling. Like I watched Raw and SmackDown like every week, and I started doing this thing called e-wrestling. You ever heard of that?
No, what's that?
It was this like internet phenomena.
Was it like fantasy wrestling, like fantasy football type of deal?
Well, yes and no. I mean, it's people called it fantasy wrestling, but it's not. It's much more participatory because it's creative writing. You make your own character.
Oh.
And you write your own like promos and like you basically write your own storyline, and then at the end of the week, you would have a match. Like slated for like the upcoming, you know, event, kind of like they do on WWE, where like you know ahead of time like who's gonna fight who. It was like that, and so you'd write your storyline, you'd be talking smack about whoever you're gonna face at the end of the week, and then at the end of the week, the people who run the federation will write this long like script of the event with all of like.
The characters.
All of the characters and the fights and all of like the promos, all the intermittent stuff.
Wow.
And they have their own storylines in the Fed, like, you know, the commissioner and whatever, all the characters.
Wow. I had not heard of that.
Super fun.
That
I was obsessed
awesome.
With it. I did it for like maybe 5 years.
Wow.
Yeah. And that's like, that was my first experience freelancing. And like, it was really like my first sort of like being on the internet. That was sort of like, that was.
doing e-wrestling for me for a long time.
That's great, man. I never heard of that. And I mean, I grew up same way, early 90s, WWF. And then kind of, you know, once I kind of graduated from high school, started focusing on like chasing girls and not really watching wrestling. And kind of just got away from it. And then recently in the last few years, I've gotten really, really into it again, mostly because of the local aspect.
Oh, yeah.
There's such a cool local scene that it reminded me a lot of local music scene, like going to shows, and you go to local shows and you see the the local dudes every week, or not every week, but like every month. I go to this one PCW. It's in Wilmington.
Cool.
And they have these dudes, and they're, you know, most of the dudes, the good people there are leaving, and they're going to bigger, they're going to WWF, they're going to, you know, whatever the new AEW, or they go to New Japan or whatever. And it's, but I've recently just gotten a new appreciation for it, just the theatrics of it.
It's such an artful thing. It's pretty impressive.
Yeah, physical art, the story building, I have always had a fascination with being able to wear like a lucha mask, like even just a mask in general. That's kind of what appealed me to ever even listen to like a Slipknot. It's just like, you know what? That's an over the top character. And
yeah.
You could be a thing. You could be that thing.
Yeah.
Know? And you take it off and you're something else. You're a normal person at home. But oh man. That's awesome, though. I mean, you should. I could probably get you into the local show if you want to check out a local show one day.
Would love to. That'd be so fun,
dude. It's
my
so great.
My girlfriend just went to a like a ladies wrestling event. She said it was awesome. It was so fun.
Yeah, bar wrestling did a whole. They called it Breastlemania, Breastlemania or something.
Breastlemania. That's awesome.
Yeah, it was. Well, they raised all the money that they made that night went to breast cancer awareness. So it was really great.
Cool.
Another question was horror movie genre. Do you want to go back to that? Is that something you really enjoy doing?
I don't know. It's not really my thing. I mean, I never thought I would do that, and then the opportunity arose, and it was really fun to give it a shot.
Okay.
So maybe. I mean, if the right project came along, I would consider it, but I think most horror movies are just, I'm just not, they don't appeal to me. And this for the same reason that I'm not really into, like, I don't know, serial murderers and stuff like that.
As I wear a Jason shirt in front of you.
I don't know. I like more positive stuff, I guess.
Okay. No, I hear you.
That's just me personally.
Yeah, I like to run the gamut. I go super silly.
I don't mind a little bit of darkness, but when it's like, I think it's when it's like, I don't know. I like when a horror movie has some sort of like heart to it. It doesn't feel like a movie that is like punishing you for watching it.
I would say maybe like Cabin in the Woods. Did you see that one?
I don't know. But I mean, like, I think of like I really liked It, like the new It movie.
I knew It.
I thought that was awesome.
It was awesome, but I mean, it was pretty freaky.
It was very scary.
Yeah.
But it had a heart. Like, I think about like,
it had that
I think about The Ring,
story. Yeah.
Which I hated because the way that movie ends, like, just drove me nuts.
Yeah.
Where it's like, oh, everything's okay, and then, no, it's not.
No, it's not.
Like, oh, these
jerks. You should check out Cabin in the Woods. It's a horror movie, but I couldn't stop laughing the whole time in the theater.
Yeah.
Because they kept doing these things, like, there was a moment, it has a Chris Hemsworth, Thor.
Yep.
He's the stereotypical, like, jock character in the movie. And there's this moment where they're running away from the monsters or whatever, and they're standing on this cliff, and he's on a motorcycle, and they put the awesome music, like the triumphant symphonic music in the background, and he's like, I'm going to make the jump. I'm going to go get help. I'm going to save us all.
Yeah.
And he jumps off the cliff, and there's like a barricade that you don't see, and he just explodes. And you have that heroic score, and like, I'm going to go save us, and then poof, he just bursts in the sky. And I stood up and started laughing and clapping. Like, that was beautiful, guys. Thank you.
Because
It's such a stereotypical thing that I thought they were going to go the stereotypical route.
Right, they were subverting your expectations.
Like, here we go, the hero. And then, like, nope. And then the whole movie just goes real silly. It's like a Truman Show. Like, there's dudes controlling the monsters in this cabin, and it's like in a barricade. And
I like when movies do that.
Yeah.
They're
There are some like Asian horror movies that are like that.
Yeah.
There's one called like Extensions or something. It's about hair extension, or it's about hair. It's really freaky, but it's also very cute because like in the middle of this ridiculous story about like you know, people's like this like hair extensions like killing people, there's like a soap opera about a family. And it's kind of like light. It's like a. It's. It feels like a Korean soap opera. Like
I'm gonna have to check
in the
that
middle
out.
Of this like crazy horror movie. So I kind of like that.
I'm gonna have to check that out. There's also Rubber. Have you heard of Rubber?
Is it the tire?
Yes.
No, I haven't seen that. Is that as ridiculous as it looks?
Yes, I tell people all the time about it. They're like, "What do you mean it's a good movie?" I'm like, "It's a movie about a tire that gains consciousness." If you don't find that hilarious, I don't know.
Never knew that was a movie I wanted to see.
Yeah, I watched it when I was getting tattooed. I was just sitting there looking at it. I'm like, why is that spare tire like moving around by itself? And then it learns telekinesis and it crushes a can with its telekinesis at one point. And then that's how it learns to kill and becomes a murderer. And
it's
spare tire. Let's see. Fez 2.
Yeah.
What happened?
It didn't happen.
It didn't happen. Did you work on any music for it at all?
No. I mean, yeah, just the teaser.
Just the teaser that came out.
Yeah. That was it.
That was weird, man. Like, I loved that game, and I was very excited when I heard it. The second one was coming, and then it just didn't happen.
Mm-hmm.
I figured, you know, I don't remember the exact scenario or what happened, but I know it had something to do with social media, right? Like, didn't Phil Fish, the creator, have some kind of problem online and like,
yes.
fans kind of tortured him or something?
I don't really know the whole story. I know that he, there was some kind of thing that happened on social media, or at least he announced that he wasn't making the game on social media.
I feel like something happened.
It was part of a stream of communication about some grievances that he had with someone, the media or gamers, or I can't remember honestly. It was a really long time ago.
Cool. Yeah. So we're gonna drink a Beechwood Mocha Machine.
Actually, I'm gonna pee.
Go do that.
But this is delicious.
I will pour myself a glass of the Beechwood Mocha Machine Imperial Coffee Chocolate Porter, local beer from Huntington Beach. We're going to get a little clip from Rich in a few whenever we're done talking crap. Oh my God, that tastes like coffee. I'm like looking through my list of questions here and I feel like we have gone through all of it.
Oh.
But, you know, maybe I'll ask some quick random questions.
So, okay.
Favorite smell?
Favorite smell? Gasoline.
Gasoline. I like that. I really love, and this is weird, the smell of fresh ink.
Yeah.
I don't know why.
That is a nice smell.
I think that's...
like markers.
Markers are good.
Anything toxic, basically.
I was gonna say, are you getting high on these things, man? Gas and markers?
They're just novel, and I don't know. Oh, rubbing alcohol is also a nice smell.
See, I associate rubbing alcohol...
Unless you had a traumatic experience, in which case you might not like that smell.
It wasn't traumatic. It was just I was born with pneumonia.
Oh, wow.
And I had like a lot of fluid in my lungs, and it resulted in a youth filled with doctor's appointments and being sick. And my mother, being a Cuban, her recipe was putting a paper towel with rubbing alcohol against my nose. Breathing that was supposed to help me somehow.
Wow.
So when I think of rubbing alcohol, it's like, well, I'm sick. Let me go get the rubbing alcohol. You know what I mean? It's a weird association.
Oh. So it's a positive one. It's just...
Yeah. I mean, it heals. It's a healing factor. But also, my brain starts to think that I'm sick, you know, like, oh no, I'm sick. And which is weird because I love actual alcohol.
Yeah. That was going to be my follow up question. How did that affected your love or
No, unless it like
taste.
It affected my love for straight vodka, which is the one that smells most like rubbing alcohol.
In the sense that you love it or you don't love it, or something in between.
It.
Yeah,
I love it. No, I mean, I'm not an alcoholic. I've actually been drinking a lot less since leaving the industry and joining the video game industry. But
so this is like your excuse to do it.
Yeah. Cool. Now I drink. I have all these beers just laying around at home. Most of these I've had at home, and this one with the crazy label from Brewery West I picked up just because I wanted it.
I like it. That one's it's a good beer. I like this one too.
Yeah, the coffee one's great. This bearded Iris Brewing. Your DDH Citra is nice, but it's cheesy.
Well, to me, that I'm sure other people would like it.
Yeah, sure. All right, alcohol of choice. Favorite kind when you go out with your girl or something for dinner or a date?
Oh, I kind of flip-flop between beers and cocktails and wine. Liquor wise, I like mezcal. I like gin. I don't know.
I like gin. Gin and tonic is my go-to cocktail for going out. That or if they have good bourbon, maybe I'll pick one up.
Yeah, I'm pretty generally pretty chill about it.
And you said, you know, earlier we talked and we're in California, so it's legal. So we'll talk about it. You don't really smoke much, marijuana, weed, mm-mm, which is odd to me for the style of music you make. Something that's so atmospheric and ethereal kind of sounding. And, I feel like I would want to be stoned while doing that kind of music.
Well, I feel like just because like a music maybe suits being high doesn't necessarily mean that writing the music is suited by being high.
That is true.
I've only tried to write music once high and it was a disaster. It didn't go well at all. So
interesting.
I don't have enough data points to, you know, actually say something definitive about it, but I've smoked weed enough to know that I've never really had a great experience with it.
So you're not a productive smoker. Like if you smoke, it doesn't make you productive. It makes you lazy.
And it doesn't make me it doesn't make me lazy. It makes me either neurotic or like weird. It just makes me feel weird. I don't know. Like either I feel paranoia, lost, or I can't feel my, you know, like my hand feels funny, or like it's just stupid stuff. It doesn't really make me giggly, or I don't know,
happy, or
yeah, I don't really like it.
Okay,
that much, I guess.
You're in the right town then.
I like alcohol.
Alcohol's nice. Because you can control it too. I feel that as you're drinking, if you manage it properly and you have water in between drinks, you can actually drink all night and not be plastered, you know, if you're in control of how you're drinking.
Right.
Whereas if you smoke or you'll eat like a pot edible or something, you may not be in control of yourself for a while.
Yeah, it's kind of a crapshoot, I guess.
Yeah, if you get drunk, you eat some food and drink some water and you get back.
Is that getting any easier? I mean, now that like it's becoming legalized, is it getting easier to know what you're smoking?
Yeah, and it's way more controlled. The edibles, for example, now like they break it down by the milligram.
Yeah.
So you can, you know, if you're not, you don't have a high tolerance or anything like that, you could just take, you know, this little bit and you know that that's how much you're getting.
Cool.
It's good. And also the it going legal also brought forth a lot more of the CBD applications, which don't give you the psychoactive, trippy high that you
I've
get.
Tried that too, and I didn't feel anything.
Well, maybe CBD does require like taking more of than you would normally. So, for example, me, I need to take at least 100 milligrams of CBD to feel anything.
Mm.
And that's a lot. Like, that's a whole bag of gummies in some places. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because I've smoked so much pot growing up in high school and all that I need that much in order for it to even affect me.
And how did that make you feel, the CBD gummies?
It just makes me, it makes my body feel rubbery, but not out of control. You know what I mean? Like I have a lot of neck issues and shoulder issues from moshing and jumping off stages and being an idiot. so the CBD kind of just makes the pain go away and I feel bouncy, you know, like, all right, I can actually move.
If the pain's gone away and you're like moving freely, when the effect wears off, does the pain
get stronger? Like,
does it affect? Yeah, does the pain change, or is it the same pain?
It's the same. It's the same.
It's not like you're doing. You're overexerting.
Right. Yeah. I'm not damaging it further.
Because you can do that. You can do that when you're having sex.
Yeah.
Like your body, like chemical, like it sends chemicals through your body that tell it to what do you call it? Like nullify your, or not nullify, but numb your pain sensors.
Sure.
And so sometimes you can like injure yourself
when you're having sex
because you don't know. And then you're like, oh fuck.
Yeah. It's happened. Like you're so focused on the situation that, you're not thinking about, like, you know, your elbow or whatever, you know, your knee, your right knee goes out.
So I was wondering if it was like that, basically.
Yeah, no, it's, I don't think, I mean, unless you're doing extenuating exercise or some kind of...
Taking a bunch of CBD and then, like, wrestling.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. I could feel that, you know, you could definitely kind of like that Novocaine effect when you go to the dentist and your lips are numb and then, like, you bite it and then you're like, oh, I bit my lip for an hour, and now it's sore when the...
Yeah, it's bleeding. I can't feel it, but it's bleeding.
Yeah, and then like later, it's going to hurt like hell.
Yeah.
It's not like that. It's not like a numbing... It's not like a numbing effect. It's more of just... it just goes away.
Cool.
And I feel flexible, I guess. I don't know.
Flexible.
Yeah. One of the things that I used to like to drink and have sex, and I actually, as I've gotten older, had to like stop that.
Yeah, I never liked that.
I used to because it was my go-to move.
Right, right.
Like, if I'm going to go out with a girl, I'm going to have a couple drinks and we'll loosen up and, you know, do the thing.
Yeah. I think for the social aspect, it's great for that. But I feel like for some, like, being drunk and having sex, or not even drunk, just, like, even being, like, buzzed and having sex, it, like, if it, like, affects your, like, senses or, like, your ability to, like, feel things.
Yeah.
I just feel kind of sloshy, for lack of a better way of explaining it.
No, yeah, it's definitely a thing. And I mean, there's the common term, the whole whiskey dick thing.
Oh, I never heard that one before.
Apparently, if you drink a lot of whiskey, you can't perform.
Oh.
It hasn't happened, but I know people that it's happened to. I don't like drinking anymore while doing that because dehydration.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I start cramping. My calves start cramping, you know, like the back, my hamstrings. I'm like, oh, my God, I need water. I'm old.
Hold on. I got to get a drink of water.
Yeah, hold on. Break.
Let's take a break.
Tea. cool, man. Well, we've been talking for about an hour and 20 minutes. I'll wrap this up. We're going to do some musical thingies.
Sure, yeah.
If you're down.
I'm down.
Cool.
What am I doing? I'm just going to play. Just
do whatever, man. I like... if you don't mind, I like Chippy Tunes.
Chippy Tunes?
I've never...
You want me to play some secret hits?
Sure. Yeah. I've never been in the presence of someone who creates that kind of music. Like, it's always been musicians that play instruments and live-sounding things. Like, I want to see how that works.
Oh, you want to see how the pizza gets made?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, okay. I can do that for a little bit.
Thank you so much for talking. People following you on so you know I found a, it was kind of difficult to find you on social media. I don't know if you did it on purpose.
Why?
Well, what I put Disasterpeace, like DIS, like disaster, how it's spelled.
Oh yeah, well I wasn't able to get the proper spelling on certain.
So now I found DZ.
That's me.
Disasterpeace.
Yeah.
So at Disasterpeace, you can also, I guess.
Except for Twitter. Twitter is DIS.
DIS, okay.
Yeah.
So on Twitter, you're
that. Facebook and Instagram, I think. I don't really use social media that much. But
why?
You need. Why?
As a musician, as a professional musician, why?
I mean, I just use it to like announce important things.
I've also noticed like your Instagram posts don't have words. They're just pictures.
Oh, yeah. I don't know.
That's good, though.
Yeah.
It's really weird. On the podcast, whenever I put a bunch of hashtags and words, mm-hmm. I don't get as many hits as if I were just post a picture.
I kind of decided that I didn't want to have a social relationship with the entire world.
Understandable.
So
a lot of people.
I kind of just closed the world off to my personal life a little bit. And I just, so now it's just kind of like things that are related to my music that I share, and that's kind of it.
Cool.
I don't really use social media that much, like personally, like for communication or anything like that. I use it for certain things for sure, but I try to reach out to people directly and not just like let the feed wash over me and dictate what I'm going to do or what I'm going to react to every day, because I've found that it was just not benefiting me personally. So
sure. Yeah, it's a lot, man. I have to use it to promote the podcast and to get guests sometimes. I reach out to a lot of them via Instagram and stuff like that. Like for you, I reached out via your website.
Cool.
Right? I think
that I was think an email. So, yeah.
It was an email.
Yeah, and your email was like, I'd love to have you on the show. And that was it. And I had to like look, I had to look up who you were. I was like, who is this guy? I was like rock and roll beer guy.
I'm sorry about that. I've been doing that lately because I've
I thought maybe you're like a hot shot.
Well, no, I want you to look it up. Like I want people to look it up. Like
that's cool.
I don't want to have to sit there and try and sell myself to someone like, hey, look, I have this thing, and like it says rock and roll beer guy, but it doesn't have to be about beer.
Yeah.
And you know, because I've had
it's
that
enough
scenario.
That it's like, like I'm curious what this is.
Well, I'm glad it worked out. Thank you for inviting me over.
My
to
pleasure.
The studio
it's nice
and,
to have you here.
And
this
talking
has been fun.
For an hour and a half. Follow social media, all that stuff, guys. Thanks for listening. Cheers.
Bye.